Hi, thank you for joining. My name is Mri Terrill, and I am the Director of Product Management at Persyst. Today I'm going to talk about EEG electrical source imaging and some of its characteristics, including that it has shown to be accurate, useful, and now you'll see that with Persyst, it's practical. Here's a brief overview of what the talk will include. We'll start off with a definition of what is electrical source imaging. We'll touch briefly on the evolution of the technology, and we'll talk about where the research is coming from. We'll talk about what that research is indicating, including that ESI is both accurate and useful. And we'll talk about some of the current barriers that still exist in terms of the routine implementation of ESI. We'll talk about the Persyst contribution and our attempts to address some of those barriers. We'll talk about some of the technical aspects of Persyst ESI. And finally, the last three slides are a bibliography listing all of the papers that went into this talk. So first of all, what is ESI? EEG electrical source imaging is a neuroimaging modality that uses a patient's EEG data co-registered with their MRI to localize the source of the scalp EEG signals within the patient's brain. ESI has been around for about 30 years and first developed as an experimental field where researchers and scientists attempted to calculate where the EEG at the scalp was coming from within the brain using basic models. As technology in general advanced, this in turn created opportunities for the field of ESI and affected what could be achieved, to the extent that now, many years later, it is possible to create a detailed, patient-specific, anatomical, and mathematical models that have affected the accuracy and clinical utility of electrical source imaging. The research that has been carried out over the years has been done at a number of centers all over the world. And combining what we've learned over the years with the most advanced technology available, recent research shows that electrical source imaging using the IFCN25 EEG electrode array performs within the same range of accuracy as other conventional neuroimaging modalities. In fact, using the 25 EEG electrode array as defined by the IFCN, levels of ESI accuracy as high as 85% can be achieved. This is notable, given that up until recently, it was thought that accuracy of this level with ESI was dependent on very high EEG channel counts. However, the literature now shows this level of accuracy can be achieved with the EEG arrays and systems you're already using today, provided that other variables remain consistently high. Of the studies that you see here, the way that accuracy is being defined is whether the ESI result fell within the resected area and whether the patient was postoperatively seizure-free for at least 1 year. Here's another example from recent literature that speaks to the levels of accuracy ESI can now achieve. In an example paper from Coito et al. From 2019, they say that using low-density EEG, they showed that ESI can reliably localize the epileptogenic zone from interictal spikes in 90% of temporal lobe epilepsy and 57% of extra temporal lobe epilepsy patients. Finally, we have an example from the Tatum et al. Review paper from 2018, which included an assessment on the accuracy of ESI. In one prospective study, 28 consecutive epilepsy patients were assessed for surgical candidacy. First, a surgical plan was established after the patient's data was collected from phase 1 and done without ESI. Then, the ESI results were introduced and incorporated into the decision making. But the physicians were blinded to the conclusions that were made previously without the ESI. Any changes made to the surgical plan based on the ESI were assessed. Later, the ESI results were subsequently compared with the stereo EEG estimated epileptogenic zone for an assessment of accuracy. The conclusions were that ESI correctly restricted localizations to the sublobar level in 73% of MRI-negative epilepsy patients. These are often the most complicated group of patients. The overall sublobar concordance of ESI with the epileptogenic zone is consistent with the previously reported ESI concordance rates of 84 to 94%. Of equal importance to accuracy is that a neuroimaging modality provide clinically reliable, non-redundant information that meaningfully contributes to the surgical decision-making process. Indeed, as the technological and methodological approaches for ESI have improved, studies also confirm that ESI is a valuable clinical tool and should be part of any pre-surgical epilepsy evaluation. In the Fauge et al. Study from 2020, ESI led to a change in the management plan for 34% of patients undergoing pre-surgical evaluation. The majority of these patients who had their plans changed was having to do with the intracranial EEG implantation planning. In addition to contributing to phase 2 planning, ESI also contributed meaningfully in other clinical decisions, including determining whether a patient should continue with the pre-surgical evaluation. Within the same patient cohort, 9% of these patients went on to phase 2, who otherwise would have been stopped in the pre-surgical evaluation program. And here are three more examples from the literature, all concluding that ESI is useful and should be included in the clinical pre-surgical epilepsy evaluation. The first example is from the Mejivan paper from 2013, saying that electrical source imaging should be part of the pre-surgical evaluation of all patients considering epilepsy surgery. Next, there's a quote from the Riker 2014 paper, saying the added value of ESI is particularly high in patients with malformations of cortical development and negative MRI, who represent the most challenging cases for epilepsy surgery. And most recently, in a published editorial, Benitsky and Trinka concluded in 2020 that ESI provides clinically useful information for planning the surgical therapy. Despite the fact that ESI has been shown to have high levels of accuracy and to also be clinically useful, the adoption rate of ESI has actually been quite slow. Why is this? In fact, a recent study from 2016 showed that of 25 level 4 epilepsy surgical centers across both the US and Europe, that among them it was found that only 9 out of the 25 centers used ESI at all. Further, among these 9 centers, the method of ESI application was quite different. So again, why is this the case? Why has the routine adoption of ESI been so slow? What we understand is that current ESI workflows are technically complex, clinically burdensome, and expensive. In short, the problem is a practical one. The typical model for performing ESI at a single center involves a highly trained individual who is dedicated to producing the ESI results. Given the complexity of the workflows and processing, the time spent to arrive at a set of results for a single patient can be anywhere from 8 to 24 hours. Further, to perform ESI requires expensive software packages and additional equipment typically. Given that different techniques and pipelines can be implemented within the same software package, there is a risk of error. Finally, the dedicated person may not always be available to perform ESI, relegating this to a modality that cannot be relied upon by the surgical team for every patient. Given these barriers, the Persyst contribution has been to develop a solution for ESI that directly addresses them, where you can perform ESI using the software, equipment, and skills that you already have. The ESI solution from Persyst is integrated with all major EEG systems. It works with and is validated on the standard 19 to 25 EEG channel arrays. It does scale up to 256 channels if your institution is already using high density or if you're interested in high density EEG. It does not require additional hardware or special expertise, and you get results in 3 steps. Broadly, Those three steps are to first mark the spikes, select the patient's MRI, and then get results. All of this has been made possible as a result of a collaboration between Persyst and Epilog. We have actually been working together for several years already, and during that time, Epilog have developed a secure, HIPAA-compliant, FDA-cleared, and CE-marked secure cloud solution for ESI. The Epilog standalone ESI solution implements a standardized approach based on best practices and incorporates Persyst spike detection as part of the pipeline. In fact, there are a number of top institutions around the U.S. and Europe who have accepted this model and are using Epilog's standalone ESI platform today. Now, we have integrated the Epilog platform directly into the Persyst software to provide a reliable and practical end-to-end solution, resulting in Persyst ESI powered by Epilog. I mentioned briefly that there are three broad steps involved: marking spikes, selecting the MRI, and getting the results. But how does it work? And what exactly do you get? Diving a little bit more into the details of the workflow, first, you would open your EEG file within the Persyst software. You can either run the automated Persyst spike detection, or you can also manually mark spikes in the file. When you're done interpreting the file, you can click the Persyst ESI button from the left-hand toolbar, which brings up an ESI patient list. This is a list of all of the patients that you have done or are currently performing ESI on within your institution. From this patient list, you select the patient that you want to perform ESI on, and you navigate to their EEG file. Similarly, you then navigate to their MRI file and select it as well. After both of these data sets have been uploaded, there will be a short processing time, and you can access the results within 48 hours. So what are the results? First, you get a PDF report. Second, you get the results within an MRI viewer, where you can visualize the ESI results within the patient's own MRI. First, I'll talk about the PDF report. The PDF report gives a detailed summary about how many spike clusters were detected, where they lateralized to on the scalp, and details about the detected spikes within each cluster. The source imaging results are reported on at different time points along the spike waveforms, including the onset of the spikes, the half-rising phase, and the peak of the spikes. The report also provides information on the 3D patient-specific head model that was used to perform source imaging. All this to say is the clinician is provided with a detailed report, which they then must interpret the clinical implications of based on what they know about that particular patient. The second part of the results that you get are within an MRI viewer. The results can also be downloaded or viewed within your browser. This allows the physician to navigate themselves to spikes and time points of interest within the patient's own MRI volume. So what you see after all this is that given the value and the utility of electrical source imaging, combined with the barriers that exist in the field, Persyst and Epilog felt that we were well positioned to provide an integrated solution for clinicians, hoping to increase the adoption of this tool. It is the most advanced solution available, backed up by years of research and publications. No ESI solution is more accurate. It continues to rely on essential physician input while easing the computational burden. The head model constructed is of the highest resolution available and made from the patient's own MRI. It is a finite difference model with a 3mm³ resolution. Within the head model, there are 6 different individual tissue types defined, and the gray matter is parcellated into 25 sublobes per hemisphere. The distributed linear inverse method used is S-Loretta, which is the most appropriate for a highly constrained individual head model. The source of each user-defined spike and spike cluster is calculated at the onset, the half-rising phase, and at the peak. In conclusion, we see that with Persyst ESI can be practical. It's efficient, where you get results within 48 hours after submitting the data. It's flexible. Multiple staff members can perform ESI. It's cost-effective, and you can use it on an unlimited amount of patients for one low annual price. The results that you get back, you can rest assured, are based on the best practices that the field has available, thereby eliminating any potential for user error. This allows you to explore more patients, which results in higher yields and ultimately supports a successful surgery program. That's the end of the talk. The next three slides are a list of all of the publications that went into the making of this talk. Thank you. If you have any questions, please reach out.